be on air with you, not only on cruise. We are up now. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Wiley Drake Show. Welcome to the international version on the internet of the Wiley Drake Show. I'm not up on the screen here, but I should be up on your screen there, folks. And we thank you, and we are here. Thank you, and welcome to the Congressional Prayer Conference. I'm looking at a picture here from an email I just received with our fellows down in Houston. Reverend Pat Mahoney, Reverend Rob Shank, and others are on their knees out below the steps at City Hall as we speak in Houston, Texas. We're going to be in Houston a lot this next few days. We're going to Houston on Thursday. We'll be there Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, and we'll be praying there where these fellows are praying. We'll be at City Hall. We'll be there with David Allen blowing the shofar and so forth. So we thank the Lord for the opportunity to be with them, and we will be down. They're down there now. They're doing a press conference, and they're going to ask for a meeting with Mayor Anise Parker. As you know, Mayor Anise Parker is a sodomite mayor, and she recently had a wedding ceremony out here in California with her other sodomite lover, whatever you want to call him. It's not love, it's lust. In fact, her other sodomite luster, they lay down together, two women, in a violation of Scripture. And now she has said she wants to subpoena the sermon notes of all the pastors who have spoken against sodomy. Well, there was an uproar about that, and she decided she would try to play political with us, and she removed the word sermon from the subpoena, and she put in speeches. Well, ladies and gentlemen, whether it's a sermon, a speech, a dance, a talk, or whatever it is, we have freedom in this country. We're in America. We're in the United States of America, and we have freedom of speech under the First Amendment. Now, that doesn't give us that right. God gives us a right. Those five pastors that have been subpoenaed, their records have been subpoenaed, they have rights given them from God. And we're going to Houston. We're going to take a holy weekend to Houston this next weekend, and we hope you'll join us. We'll be talking about that in a little bit. But right now, this is sort of our Hollywood week, and we're going to be talking to another gentleman here on the air in just one moment. I'm going to try to bring him up, see if we can get him up on the air. And when I get him up, if he's not loud enough, if you can't hear him, let me know, and I'll use the other phone. But I'm going to put him on the conference call line right now. I think I can work that out. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to call. Mr. Jimmy Rogers, ladies and gentlemen, and Lord willing, we're going to have an interview with him here in just a few moments. This is sort of Hollywood week for us. We were in Hollywood last night. Hello? Hello, Mr. Rogers, are you there? Mr. Jimmy Rogers, are you there? We're trying to hook up with Jimmy Rogers, ladies and gentlemen. You will remember Kisses Sweeter. Hello? Hello, is this Jimmy Rogers?
Yes.
Well, Mr. Rogers, thank you for joining us today. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I can. I've got a little husky throat today, but I can still talk.
All right.
Right now, I'm outside working in my garden right now, so this is good.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have Jimmy Rogers on with us, and this is sort of our Hollywood week. We were in Hollywood last night, Mr. Rogers, with one of the great movie producers of our time, a fellow by the name of Michael Franzesis. Michael Franzesis used to be a member of the mob. He was in La Costa Nostra. His father went to prison, is still in prison, and he went to prison. And while he was in prison, he met the Lord Jesus Christ, got saved miraculously, and produced a movie now that we premiered here in Los Angeles last night. And the name of the movie is God the Father. Great movie. It was released last night by premiere here and will open in theaters around the nation on the 31st. And we encourage you to go see that movie. Pray for this movie. Great instrument of witness for what God has done in this man's life, who even the secular press say he's the only man that ever left the mob and lived to tell about it. Now, we are now doing something else, though, with another gentleman who has been in the media and has been in Hollywood and has been very, very famous. You see, back in our previous years, many of us that were of my age bracket, living in the 50s and the 60s, remember a beautiful, beautiful song, Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. And then another one that had sort of an unusual name, but we all remember it, and it was, Uh-Oh, I'm Falling in Love Again. Ladies and gentlemen, I have Jimmy Rogers on the line with us, the man who produced that and sang that. Mr. Rogers, how are you today? Well, that's a good sign. A friend of mine always says when I ask him how he's doing, he'll say, well, I'm above ground, and that's a good sign, a good way to start the day. Amen.
Well, thank you for calling. I will go see that motion picture. You know, my life story is being looked at very carefully for a film. I wrote a book called Dancing on the Moon, which is all about my career in the Lord. And I finished like a chapter with things from the Bible in my book. And so, you know, I certainly appreciate people who are starting to do some motion pictures for everybody. You know what I mean? For families.
Yes, amen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to encourage you. This gentleman we're talking to, as I said, is Jimmy Rogers, and he has had a great history, great career. But as he mentioned, we'll talk more about this in a little bit, but as he mentioned, he was brutally attacked a number of years ago, and the old devil does everything he can to stop men of God and women of God who are proclaiming the gospel. And the book that Jimmy is referring to is available now, correct?
Yes, it's in my website, which is just jimmyrogers-rogers.com. I spell my name Jimmy with an I-E, and the name Rogers with a D, and but it's jimmy-rogers.com. It's very easy for people to order it, and they'll get it to me, and I'll sign it for them and send it from my home. So I'd love to have the people read the book.
All right. Now, let us do it again. Let's make sure we've got it. It's J-I-M-M-I-E hyphen R-O-D-G-E-R-S, right?
That's correct.
Ladies and gentlemen, I have none other than our brother in Christ, Jimmy Rogers, of great Hollywood fame. I remember back in those years, I thought there were only two kinds of music. I grew up in Arkansas, grew up on Elvis, and I thought there were only two kinds of music in this world at that time, and that was country and Western. But then other folk came along like Jimmy and Elvis and many, many other great artists, and they introduced to us some new things like Kisses Sweeter Than Wine and Uh-Oh, I'm Falling in Love Again. These went top 10, and there's also one called Secretly. That would prove to be a top 10 and so forth. And
there was one called Honeycomb, too, which was my first hit record, and then Kiss is Sweeter Than Wine was the second. So I'll throw that in at you.
Well, thank you so much. And I remember very clearly, I'm not a young fella anymore. I'm 70 years of age. But I remember, Honeycomb, won't you be my baby? Well, a honeycomb be my pony. Hey, I remember that song, man. I sang that song as a young teenage boy, bouncing around the country roads and the hillsides of Magnolia, Arkansas. And I didn't know Jimmy Rogers, but I sure did know about Honeycomb.
I recorded that song in New York City. I was walking the streets looking for work, and I went into a little record company, and I asked them if I could play some music for them. I was broke and trying to get a job, and they took me to a little studio, and they heard me sing, and we recorded Honeycomb in 2 hours, and they released it, and it became a hit without a contract. I didn't know anybody or anything, so God just reached in and helped me out right there.
Amen. Well, it's amazing. It shouldn't be amazing to us, but as we watch men's lives, like Michael Franzese's In the Mob and so forth, and as we see the instrumentation, really, I call it a God thing. When we look back and we see things that occur, we see things that happen, and we think, why in the world did that happen? Why did those people allow me to do that? Why and how did I get a song done and so forth? And we look back and we say, well, even though Jimmy was willing, even though Jimmy was available, even though Jimmy was doing his thing, it literally was a God thing that happened in his life there. And Jimmy, we thank you for being with us today. What else can you tell us about your career in reference to music that some of us might remember? We do remember Kisses Sweeter Than Wine and Uh-Oh, I'm Falling in Love Again and Honeycomb and those different records. What other music might we remember?
Well, you know, some of the older folks, the kids around wouldn't remember, but Bill Weiss was one of my favorite artists in those days. And I used to collect Bill Weiss music. And when I was a kid, I didn't have a record player. We didn't even have a radio. And we lived in a place up in Washington State, up on a hill in a little town called Camas, Washington. And all we had was an outdoor toilet and no lights for a while. And I was raised with my brother and my dad and mom, and I could always sing. You know, I was a happy kid, and I still am. And I could always sing. My brother Jet couldn't even turn that song on in the radio, but I was a singer. And I've always been a singer. And when I got out of school and so on, went to college for a while. I went to Korea during the war, and I was over there for several years, and thank God came back safe. When I found in Korea that I could get that old guitar we did in the concert acts right off the front line, I had a little guitar out there, and I'd sit down at night and play songs for these guys sitting around. And I realized that people really like my music, and they'd sit around at Christmas and cry and sing songs with me. And when I got back to America, of course, I knew that I had a chance for people to hear me sing. As far as my style was folk and pop and a little bit country. I was not called a country singer. There was a late Jimmy Rogers who died in 1933, the year I was born. And he was a great country singer. And that Jimmy Rogers spelled his name the same way as I do. But I didn't know him then. I didn't even know his name. I never heard about him. But after I started recording, I did. You know, I did Child's Play, which is a song after Honeycomb and Kisses and all of those wonderful kid songs. Mm-hmm. I got hurt really bad in an accident that put me out of the business completely for a long time. And when I went back in, I recorded a song called Child of Clay. LA and did it on the Smothers Brothers show, and that song became a hit in the world through the eyes of children, and a lot of things like that that were hits in different parts of the country. I have 29 gold records now.
My goodness.
From all over the world. And right now I'm writing music and producing records, and I'm writing animation for television. And I just finished my second book a couple of days ago. And I'm busy, you know, I'm 81 years old, and I love the Lord. And I can tell you how I got to love the Lord if you want to hear it.
Well, we'd love to hear that. Before you do, let me say to you, I remember you're talking about Korea. I'm 10 years your junior, and I was in Vietnam, and I remember those kinds of circumstances you're talking about in war, where the fellows around the group would grab their guitar and sing, and I remember singing Honeycomb and with our fellows there, and then also a country western singer that I'm sure you're aware of was Hank Williams, and he had a song called I Saw the Light, and I remember one night there in Vietnam hearing these fellas sing. I liked music. I didn't sing myself, but I went over and heard that song, I Saw the Light, I Saw the Light. No more darkness, no more night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. And that night, I got down on my knees, and I prayed, and I received Jesus Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, I have Jimmy Rogers of Honeycomb. Kisses sweeter than wine. But I want him to tell us, he is, as I said, 10 years my senior, born in 1933. I was born in 1943. Jimmy, tell us how you came to know the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you please?
Trouble with that steel plate in your head, and I said, yeah. I'm hurting me, and I have double vision, and I can't walk very well. And we prayed about it that night, and when he left the house, I told my wife, I started to feel warm all over, some kind of warm air just going out of my body. And I told my wife, I said, you know, I think God just put his arms around me. I feel really strange. And I felt that way all night. And the next day, I got up and walked. That double vision went away in 2 days. I could eat. I got rid of all the pain medication in just a few weeks. And healed me. And when I was 60 years old, I was running 10 miles every other day, and I still am very healthy for my age. And you know what, God, it was a miracle, an absolute miracle from the Lord. And that's what I knew, really knew, how important Jesus is to our lives and to our loved ones. And I'll do anything I can for him because I love him a lot.
Well, brother, what a great testimony that is. And ladies and gentlemen, we're talking with Jimmy Rogers, of great notoriety, of Honeycomb and Kisses Sweeter Than Wine and many other great, great songs. How many gold records do you have?
I have 23 now, and there's more coming. Well, it's funny, you know, I've been in the business, like 55 years or so. And every once in a while, a gold record will come in the mail, and they're really have sold that many because the music industry makes sure that that's accurate that you did sell that many.
Yeah.
But I'll get them from different countries, like Australia is one, and
Amen.
Japan, and it just arrived in the mail. it's kind of cool.
Well, brother, that is great. 23 gold record recipient, ladies and gentlemen, Jimmy Rogers. And my brother in the Lord, I know this is like name dropping. We're not biological brothers, but we're spiritual brothers. He was born 10 years before I was born, and God has been good to him and is continuing to be. And one of these days, Jimmy and Wiley are going to spend eternity together in heaven. Because I, too, received Jesus as my Lord. And there was one other fella that I knew a little bit about because I grew up in rock and roll. And in fact, the matter is, my dear wife of 48 years, 1 month, and 14 days went home to be with the Lord about 4 years ago. I met her when I was in the Navy in Hawaii. And my story behind that is simple. But it's sort of funny, I think, because the night that I invited her out in 1961, her girlfriend said, "You can't go out with that guy. He's a sailor." And she said, "Well, I like him." And I was like you, typical sailor, you know, cussing, drinking, etc. Hadn't found Jesus yet. But that night she said, "No, I want to date him." And the girlfriend said, "Hey, you already have a date. You can," and she said, "Well, I'm going to cancel that date, and I'm going to go out with Wiley." Well, that date that night was canceled, and you and others will recognize the name of the young man she canceled the date with so she could go out with Wiley, the sailor. And his name was Bobby V. And so my kids say, "Well, you know, if Mom would have made the right decision, I could have grown up as a child of Bobby V rather than a child of Wiley Drake." But that's how God works. And there's also another man that I did not meet, nor did I bump him off of a date, but I did have a great deal of respect for him, and I know you did as well. And I'd like for you to tell us about your life nearly being snuffed out with a man by the name of Buddy Holly. Tell us about that, would you please?
Well, yes, after Honeycomb was recorded, there was big rock and roll shows going on in New York City and at the Brooklyn Paramount Theater. And Billy Colton, of course, was number one there for a while, for 6 weeks. And I, even though I was really not a rock and roll singer, I could do it, but I was more of a folk singer. But Buddy and I roomed together in the Brooklyn Paramount Theater. The cricket band was in one dressing room, and Buddy and I were in another. The cricket guys used to fight all the time. They were always fighting, and Buddy would come in and sit with me. And we played guitars and sang. And I just loved it. He's such a neat guy. Buddy Holly was a neat guy and a great performer. And we'd go out on stage, and all those kids would be screaming so loud that we couldn't hear a thing, you know. And we'd go up and sit in the dressing room, and we did like 6 shows a day. They'd play a movie.
My goodness.
And the rock and roll shows, and another movie, the rock and roll shows. And I worked with Buddy all up and down the East Coast. I think we did about 200 shows together off and on. And I was in the hospital. I would have been on that tour with him, but I got double pneumonia. And they had to get in the hospital out in Los Angeles, where I was living at the time. And I heard about it in the hospital. I would have been on that airplane. We were such close friends. And I cried for a long time, and I still cry when I think about it, because he was the best. He was a great guy.
Yeah, I believe the Big Bopper was on that plane with him, correct?
Yeah, as you know, I never met the Big Bopper. He came along, quite a few years later.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the other young fellow, the Mexican singer. I'll think of his name here in a second. There's a couple of them that I...
Richie Valley?
Yeah, Richie, yeah. I never had a chance to meet either one of them because they were doing rock and roll in the West Coast and so on. And I was back in New York. But, that was just such a tragedy. I've read the book several times.
Yeah.
And that book is called The Night the Music Died. I think that's the title of it.
Right.
I've lost a lot of friends in airplanes.
Yeah. Okay. Amen. Well, Brother Jimmy, give us again the title of your book.
It's called Dancing on the Moon. I was told that I would never live, and the reason I did, because I was exercising a lot before I got hurt so badly, they found the people who hurt me, but I could never prove it. The guy that beat me up, but I could never prove it because I was alone out there, and he dragged me around and left me laying next to the street, and my conductor did find me.
Brother, thank you. Thank you so much, and thank God for saving your life. You've been through a lot, and we praise God for him bringing you through, and I know you would give him all the credit. Last night, we were over there with Michael Franzese's God the Father movie, and we were right down the street from a place that you appeared with a full orchestra at one time here in California at a very famous place, one of the places I dated my wife when we were dating back in the 60s. Her mother and father didn't like the idea of her going out with a sailor, and I don't blame them, but she wanted to date me, and so her mom and dad said, okay, you can date our daughter, but you've got to go with us. And so they lived in the San Fernando Valley, and so wherever we would go, Mom and Dad would go with us. And one night they said, all right, you guys can go on a date tonight, but we're going with you. We have tickets. We have tickets to the Hollywood Bowl. And I wasn't too interested in that. I was interested in my wife, Barbara, my girlfriend then, but we went to the Hollywood Bowl, and we were there, not at the bowl last night, but very, very close to it, and you had a phenomenal concert at the Hollywood Bowl with a full orchestra, one of the best concerts with new arrangements, and I understand that the media, though, wasn't too enthused. Negative PR they gave you. Tell us about that.
Well, I was singing really well, and I had worked with small groups forever, go on, and I really was not known as a singer behind in front of a big band, but I could sing jazz, I could sing anything, you know. But anyway, I had this large orchestra, and we rehearsed for like 7 hours out there, and I thought to myself, you know, this is going to be interesting, but it's a little bit different than the people are used to. And I went out there and sang all the hits, but with a big orchestra, the people liked it, but the media didn't like it because they thought I should be out there with just a rhythm section and a few young girls and singing and so on. Well, you know, to be on the stage alone in a place that big, and if you can have a nice orchestra out there playing for the people, I thought that would be great. But they knocked me down in the newspapers and said they didn't like it. I shouldn't have done that. I tried to be Frank Sinatra and all of that. So I was pretty, you know, that hurt my feelings because I thought maybe that they were pretty cruel to me. But, you know, that's what they do when they feel like it. I don't know why that is. Sometimes some people that would come into a show of mine, and then if I got a bad review, I'd find out that they never showed up.
Yeah.
They weren't even there.
Yeah.
They just looked and said, you know, he did this, he did that. But you really have to be strong in this business.
Yes. Well, you're absolutely right, Jimmy. And ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you, we do have Jimmy Rogers on the line with us on the Wiley Drake Show. And he has written a book, and I encourage you, get that book, Dancing on the Moon. And I want to give you an incentive to get the book. Jimmy has just talked about sometimes people would write reviews of what he was doing, and they weren't even there. And I would like to offer to my listening audience right now an opportunity to come on the Wiley Drake Show and review the book, Dancing on the Moon. But now I want to remind you and warn you that if you just heard the title and haven't read the book, my producer will ask you one simple question if you call him, and he'll say, have you read the book? And if you have read the book, Dancing on the Moon by Jimmy Rogers, then my producer, Bob Bosworth, will book you on the Wiley Drake Show. And we'll give you up to 15 minutes to tell about your experience and your review with the book, Dancing on the Moon. And we want to give you that incentive. Call my producer, Bob Bosworth. His phone number is 714-699-8657, 714-699-8657. But Bob is a senior like Jimmy and me. In fact, he is probably maybe even a senior to Jimmy by a year or so. But anyway, he will ask you a very strong question. If you want to come on and review the book, he'll say, do you have the book? And if you say, well, no, but I heard about it, he will tell you, well, after you read the book, then call me back. So if you would like, I would encourage you to get a copy of Jimmy's book, Dancing on the Moon. And ladies and gentlemen, I am not his promoter. I am his brother in Christ, and I would encourage you to get the book. And he did not hire me. I am not being paid for doing it. I do want to be very selfish, though, and say, Jimmy, I would love to get a free copy of the book.
Well, you know, I'll get your address from Jim Lindsay, who was to put me in touch with you. Jim and I are really good friends. We've become great friends. And the thing that I live down in the deserts, you know, in the Palm Springs area. And I work all the time outside, and I'm writing another book now called The Seven Horsemen, which is about guns, the seven horsemen, love, death, life,
yes,
time. Yes,
yes.
And I finished The Seven Horsemen just last week. It was a five-year write.
Well, brother, we'll be looking forward to that one as well. And as I said, we do free promotion here for folk that write books that have a Bible base, and certainly yours do. And we do not charge for it, but I am a little selfish. I do ask for a free book. Because when I review it, we hold our audience accountable and say, have you read the book? So when I review your book later, I want to be able to say to those that I'm reviewing it that indeed we are, I have read the book. Hang on just a minute, Jimmy. David Allen, are you there in Houston?
Yes, Pastor
Allen. David Allen, are you, hang on there just for a moment. I'm on the line right now with Jimmy Rogers, who wrote the song Honeycomb and Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. And ladies and gentlemen, while Jimmy is on with us, I did just take another call from a shofar blower down in Houston. As many of you know, we're fighting the good fight in Houston. Brother David Allen, what's going on today in Houston?
Pastor Riley, you wouldn't believe it. I guess all I can say to your audience is, you know, we have to breathe because we serve a mighty King. We're gathered even in his name as we listen and testify. Pastor Riley, seven pastors from around the nation. Don Mahoney said hello. Rob Shank, there were other pastors from Arkansas, from Pennsylvania, all over the nation. Seven pastors came. The city shut down. They did not want them to go see the mayor, and they weren't going to allow them up there. We gathered on the front patio of City Hall. The press was there filming. The pastors spoke words of love and compassion, but firm words of the invulnerable relationship of a pastor and a flock, of the God-given direction to be free to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, and how that cannot be infringed upon by a government.
Yes.
And so this ember has been inflamed across our nation. They knelt on seven pillows. Seven men knelt on seven pillows. They had me coming. They had me supporting them and the press, and they prayed the Lord's Prayer there in front of City Hall. Then we went inside, and they changed their minds. They allowed us up into the lobby outside the mayor's office. Her chief of staff came out and met with us, and we just the seven men prayed the Lord's Prayer again in the lobby of the mayor's office right outside her door. And they relented further in that at 3:30 today, Houston time, they will have a meeting with the mayor. The mayor, her abortion and perversion agendas have been confronted, and I believe we're seeing them melt. The Holy Spirit is inflamed in the hearts of America. We're seeing something very special. I cannot believe what I witnessed here. I stood with them with my shofar. They normally don't let me up with my shofar into the mayor's lobby, but today they did. I told the officer up there, I'm sorry, but they made an exception today, and he howled with laughter. However, I witnessed to a couple of mounted, they had the mounted police out here today. I witnessed to them. They gave me the thumbs up. I told them they were being free. No longer will the mayor use the resources of the city of Houston to promote her agendas of abortion and perversion. The city of Houston is coming alive, Pastor Wiley.
Well, amen. Brother David Allen, thank you so much. Brother Jimmy Rogers, are you still on with us?
Yes, I want to tell you that Mary and I, my wife now, we've been married 36 years. And from my first marriage, I have children and married. I have one daughter. And my oldest girl is suffering from double pneumonia down in Nashville right now. And I want everybody to pray for her. Her name is Michelle.
All right, Jimmy, let me ask you to do this. I'm going to put you to work, my brother. I want you to pray for Michelle, and I want you to pray for my friends, my pastor buddies down there in Houston, Rob Shank from D.C. and Pat Mahoney, and Brother David Allen, who blows the shofar there. Brother Jimmy, would you lead us in prayer for your request and for our efforts and our witness there in Houston? Would you lead us in prayer, Jimmy Rogers?
Yes, I would. You know, ladies and gentlemen, that God, I have a thing that I go by that my daughter gave me in my computer. My computer says, what the Lord doesn't protect you from, he provides you through.
Amen. Amen.
I wish that every church in the world would come in and in the United States would come in and pray for the people with this terrible disease.
Well, we're gonna be going back to Houston. We're in Houston, and the weekend of Halloween, which is a devil's week, We're going to have a holy weekend in Houston. And Jimmy, would you lead us in prayer for that? And I'll also call you when we're down there and have you on the line with us when we're down in Houston. But Jimmy, would you lead us in prayer for Michelle and for the pastors and the people of America that we'll come back to one nation under God? Would you lead us in that prayer, please? Yes, yes.
And I know that you will, Jesus, for you're the Lord, our Savior.
Mm-hmm.
You're the doctor.
Amen.
Father, you're the doctor.
Amen, amen. Well, amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this prayer. And I want to go back just for a moment, if I could, with Jimmy. You know, we talked about the music, the rock music and so forth, and I remember talking a little while ago about my wife here in California, and she liked Kisses Sweeter Than Wine, and she liked Honeycomb, but she also was a fan there at the Hollywood Bowl of a man that I really, in all honesty, wasn't too crazy about his music at that time. I was a young kid and didn't know any better. I since have grown to appreciate him, but his name was none other than Frank Sinatra. Frank Sinatra assisted you, I believe, Jimmy. Tell us about that. Amen.
He would help people financially that he didn't know. And he came to talk to me one time and got to know me a little bit. And I did a show with him, and we became friends. And all I can tell you is that he helped me tremendously when I was hurt so badly. I heard from him, and I know he prayed for me.
Amen. Amen.
I know he pushed the buttons, but so do I, you know, sometimes.
Well, you're absolutely right, and we all are that way. David Allen, are you still on with us from Houston? David Allen, are you there? We may have lost David down in Houston. I was going to try to see if he had the shofar with him. He blows the shofar literally all over the Houston area and all over that part of the country as well. And we thank the Lord for him being on with us. Let me see. We have another caller on the line. Caller, are you there?
Oh, yes.
All right, caller, I have on the line with me now Jimmy Rogers of Honeycomb and Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. Who do we have on the line with us?
This is Josh Collins.
Well, Josh Collins, where are you calling from?
From Anaheim. I've actually been on your show once before. I'm a homeless advocate that you came and spoke with me at Anaheim.
All right. Well, thank you so much for calling. Just hang on and listen in. I'm doing an interview right now with a very famous brother in Christ, Jimmy Rogers. Jimmy, are you still with us?
Yes, I am.
Well, Jimmy, as we talk to you about your relationship with people like Buddy Holly and Frank Sinatra and so forth, what were some of the performances that you would look back on and say, this was one of my favorite performances? This was one where I really felt good about it. Tell us about one or two of those performances, would you please?
Are you talking about my name or somebody else's or the people that I admire?
Well, whatever you would like to share, brother. I know your performances were all over the country, all over the world. And ladies and gentlemen, while you're listening to me, Dancing on the Moon is a new book that is out, and I would encourage you to get that book. And if you'd like to go to it, the way to get it is go to Jimmy, J-I-M-M-I-E, hyphen Rogers, R-O-D-G-E-R-S.com. And if you get that book, like I'm going to get it, I'm not going to say a whole lot about the book because I haven't read it. But as soon as Jimmy gets me a copy of it, I will read it, and then I will give you my commentary on his book, and that's what we ask you to do. If you get the book.
You know, I'd like to tell you a story.
All right, go ahead.
Thank you for that, because I think people will enjoy the book. Matt Jinko was alive. I went to see him in New York City, and I was not a good performer. I was just a young kid, just starting. I went to this show at a big theater back in New York City, and the multitude of people came into that show and were all sitting around. They wouldn't clap, but they would bang their fingers on the tables. And Nat Cole, and they were being rude to Nat King Cole, and they were talking through the show and everything. But he just had a little four people at the piano, and he started singing softly, more soft than he was, until he sang so quietly that everybody was telling all these people to shut up and listen to the show. And pretty soon, Nat Cole was, they were standing up screaming at how great he was.
Amen.
And after the show, I went back to his dressing room, and he had a lot of people there, and I waited, and he told me to come in and sat down. And he asked me a few questions about my music and so on. And I'm ashamed of singing it with him. I've loved his music all my life. And I told him, I said, Mr. Cole, how did you do that? How did you change that? It's for them to not even be listening to you do that. He said, Jimmy, the first thing you do is you do your music.
Yes.
And you follow noise with silence. You do an up-tempo song, and then you do a quiet song. And you don't scold them. You entertain them by making them listen. If you talk quietly and so on, they will pretty soon start to listen. That was the greatest lesson I ever got from an entertainer. Sinatra told me some things like that, too.
Amen. Well, we certainly do thank you, Jimmy, for sharing some of your stories with us today, and we praise the Lord for your ministry. And you talked about Nat King Cole. What a great, mighty singer he was, and his daughter, Natalie, is doing a great job. I met her not too long ago at a Hollywood thing, and somebody said, well, tell Mrs. Cole what you'd like to say, and I said, well, Natalie, I'll just say an old Arkansas phrase, the nut didn't fall too far from that tree. And Natalie is indeed a female, very feminine, but a female version of Nat King Cole. What a great singer she is in her own right. And Natalie, if you're listening, give me a call. We'd love to have you come on the show as well. Now, Jimmy, we're talking with you about all of your experiences, and of course you've had almost 80 years of experience, but you were in the Air Force, and being a military man, I picked up on that a little bit. And after you left the Air Force, though, you went to Washington, and how did your career develop from there?
Working like 7 hours a night for $10 a night for free drinks. And that's what I was thinking.
Well, Jimmy, you know, as we share about and reminisce back about our military days, we have some great fond memories. Some of them probably we'd like to forget, but some of them are very fond. But in your case, some of your buddies played a prank on you. Tell us about that prank they played on you and something to do with a Korean dress-up. And so tell us about that.
Well, I'm not quite sure I remember which one. Everybody plays tricks on people. Where we were, we were just a little ways. I was in a town called Yeongdang Po, right on the Han River. And just a little bit away from anybody around, you know, no big cities. But we would sleep at night in a closet sometimes and sometimes not. But the North Koreans would come across the Han River sometimes at night and attack things like the chow hall and everything. And one night they wiped out the chow hall. I was working at base operations that night. I couldn't go to chow. They killed everybody in the chow hall, so we were pretty scared. And I was asleep in bed, and a couple of my buddies, the lights were off, and a couple of my buddies had the house boy, he was a South Korean, to take one of the guns. And he came up, and he punched me with a gun. And then Korean told me to get up. And they were going to kill me, and I couldn't see, and it was too dark. And I tell you what, that was not funny.
I can imagine.
But, you know, when you dribble for the bunch of men, dig a big hole in the ground and cover it with ice and put beer down there. We didn't drink whiskey or anything, and everybody would sit around and sing and play jokes on one another and fight. You know, most of the time, a lot of the fights would start, and you'd have to be able to protect yourself. And I carried a gun all the time because I was teaching weapons. I was a great shot in the Air Force, and I became a weapon guy that taught other people how to shoot. So I thought it was the guy that handled the weapons in the closet, and I was the one that had to hand them out. Over there, you were never safe. My little dog got distemper, and I didn't know what it was, and I drove an old truck all the way 14 miles to another base and had a veterinarian up there in the middle of the night, right on an old dirt road with Koreans all around me, and got up there alive with my little dog, and his name was Dozo, which means please. And the vet said, well, he's got distemper, he may not make it back. And on the way home, I had to drive that big truck with the lights off because I was in bad territory. And 14 miles back to K-16, and the little dog died on my lap, and I cried all the way down that mountain with my lights off.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it sounds like to me that God has had his hand upon Jimmy Rogers, not only because of his success, but here you've heard some of his stories where he would have been on that plane with Buddy Holly, but he was ill and couldn't go, and therefore God's hand was on him to save his life from that plane crash. And this other situation that he was beat up here in Los Angeles, and most men would have died. But God saw fit to see him through and continues to see him through. So it's obvious to me, not only in protection, but in projection, if you will, of his music. As we talked earlier, 23 gold records that many of us, if we would hear the beginning of them, would be able to sing along with those songs. Jimmy Rogers has been a great inspiration to many, many pastors, many, many people. And Jimmy, thank you for being with us today. And anything else you'd like to share with our listening audience?
Yes, right now, because my voice is not like it used to be, I do shows still at my age. And we play the songs, and everybody sings along with me, and I go out in the audience and entertain people. And if anybody knows theaters that would like me to come, I'd be happy to do that. Also, churches. I speak to churches whenever I can, and I tell my story, and we get there. Any money that comes in for that goes to charity. There's one little girl in Chicago that I've helped for within the last 45 years, the little Jenny Clean, the Chicago area, and we give help her. And some children come to our house, and they love us for us for. Yeah, so, you know, I'm available to help in any way I can.
Well, Jimmy, we certainly do appreciate that. And ladies and gentlemen, we have Jimmy Rogers on with us. Our good friend, Jim Lindsay, who's a chaplain, as introduced here, had the opening premiere here at our church in Buena Park, just up the street from Knott's Berry Farm, for the Military Bible. And then later he said, Wiley, I would like to have someone I think you may know of come on the show. And I want to say to Brother Jim Lindsay and his dear mother, those folks that are serving the Lord, thank you, Jim, for having and setting this up with this great man of God, Jimmy Rogers. And Jimmy, our church is open to you. We're in Buena Park, just up the street from Knott's Berry Farm. We would love for you to come and do a concert and give your testimony here at our church. And Jim Lindsay, you've sort of become my agent with Jimmy. So if you will work that out, we'll set that up. We'd love to have you here at the First Southern Baptist Church and Messianic Fellowship of Buena Park, which is also the headquarters of the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. And Jim Lindsay, thank you for setting this up. And thank you. And please, let's work on that. And folks, get the book. Get the book, Dancing on the Moon. Call my producer, Bob Bosworth, who schedules some of the interviews. And he will... if you've read the book, you get the book and read it. He will book you on the Wiley Drake Show. Won't cost you a dime. You can come into our studio here just up the street from Knott's Berry Farm, or you can come on by phone as Jimmy did. Jimmy, where do you live now?
I live in Palm Desert, down in Palm Springs. Excuse me. And my wife's parents were ill. I was in Branson, Missouri for 12 years doing shows and writing music and actually directing shows down there. And I came here, and we've been here almost 12 years now. I bought a home here. And I'm semi-retired. I go out and sing once in a while, and I teach golf. I guess I'm certified to teach golf. And I'm a character. I skydive. I used to skydive, and people think I'm a little crazy.
Well, brother, we had a saying. I served on the USS Kitty Hawk, an aircraft carrier, and we had a jump crew come in one time, and we had a saying there on the Kitty Hawk, I'm not jumping out of a perfectly good airplane.
Well, are you there?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm going to do everything I want to do. I've got a little 65 Mustang convertible that I rebuilt and helped rebuild that I love to drive. And I got a big truck that I do all my own yard work and go to the dump.
Amen.
And when I teach golf, I don't tell them who I am.
Amen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we have the living legend by the name of Jimmy, J-I-M-M-I-E, Rogers, R-O-D-G-E-R-S. And if you want to get in touch with him, Jimmy-Rogers, R-O-D-G-E-R-S.com. Get his book, Dancing on the Moon. Jimmy, we've just about run out of time. I'm not going to pull the plug just yet. We'll go on a little bit. But I want to say, first of all, to Jim Lindsay, thank you for arranging this. We've talked about Jimmy's life, and several God things that happened in his life. And I believe one of the God things that happened in my life as a former military man, as a man who's working with veterans, one of the God things that happened with me was that God brought Jim Lindsay into my life with the military Bible, and we have those and we give them out to the veterans here at our church and at our shelter, and we thank the Lord for that opportunity. And I want to say thank you again to Jim for getting Jimmy Rogers on with us. And Brother Rogers, thank you for your prayer earlier. Please pray for us. We're going to be doing a very special event on Sunday. And if it's okay with you, I'd like to book you right now by telephone. And on Sunday, we're going to be in Houston, and we're going to be doing a thing called I Stand Sunday. And we're going to have thousands and thousands of people all over our nation watching a live webcast, at 4 p.m. Palm Desert time. And I would like to be able to call you back on this phone about 4 o'clock on Sunday and have you lead us again in prayer on this webcast literally around the world. And I have your number, and I'll call you. Now, before we do sort of pull the plug on this program, ladies and gentlemen, I have the privilege of having none other than Jimmy Rogers on the line with us. And Jimmy, I want to give you the last word, my brother. What else would you share with our audience? Amen. And ladies and gentlemen, right now, as a minister of the gospel, as the chairman of the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C., I am Wiley Drake. And Heavenly Father, I know you know my name. I talk to you every day, several times. And right now, Lord, I pray for James Frederick Rogers, better known to those of us fans as Jimmy Rogers. But James Frederick Rogers, Lord, I bring to you as my brother in Christ. I pray for his body, for his soul, and for his spirit. I thank you, Lord, that you spared him in that plane crash. You spared him through the beating that he received. And you have blessed and spared him all these years. Lord, born in 1933, 10 years before I was born. But Lord, I pray and I thank you for his birth and my birth. And we thank you, Lord, for your intervention. And we'll be working. We'll be having Jimmy back on here again in the very near future. Jimmy Rogers, thank you, my brother. God bless you and have a great, great day down there in the desert, Palm Desert, California, not too far from here in Buena Park. One of my dear friends over the years was Walter Knott here at the Knott's Bear Farm, and he used to tell me his favorite place to get away. He and his wife had the berry stand. It started off and then became a great amusement park, and before he passed away, when he was still very much alive, he told me one time, he said, Wiley, I need to go now because my dear wife is waiting for me, and we're going to get away for a few days. And he said, I'm going to my favorite place to get away. It was not too far away, not a bad drive, but Walter Knott and Cordelia would go down to Palm Desert and meet with the Lord. And we have now down there, of course, Walter and Claudia is in heaven now, and but our dear brother, Jimmy Rogers, is there in the desert. And we thank you for being with us, my brother. God bless you.
Well, thank you so much. It's such an honor to talk to you. And, of course, being in Palm Desert is nice. I'm sitting outside now. It's about 75 degrees.
Amen.
And I'm sitting in a chair in my front yard, waving at people going by and working in the garden.
So, amen.
God bless you. I'm so happy to be alive. And God bless you.
Well, God bless you, Jimmy. And ladies and gentlemen, if you're listening, this is for Jimmy and this is for you. If you'd like to see this show again, all you have to do is go to thewileydrakeshow.com, thewileydrakeshow.com on your computer, and you can see it, and you can see me in the studio. You won't see Jimmy because he's not in the studio, but you will hear all of this audio on the video. Jimmy Rogers, thank you so much, my brother, for being on with us today. Jim Lindsay, thank you for arranging this. And we want to give Jesus Christ all the honor and all the glory. And we say this all in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Jimmy, goodbye and God bless.
God bless you.
And thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, that ends our show now. We're going to go off of the other lines that we were on. We're going to go off Crusade Radio and remind Crusade Radio that the theme for this program is do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with God. And we're going to go off of Crusade Radio. And we want to remind you that this prayer communication channel will be open several times in Houston. Please stay tuned. And we want you to know the title of today's show is Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. And that, of course, was one of Jimmy's great songs. Kisses Sweeter Than Wine. Kisses from God, kisses from each other. May God bless you and give you a great day. This is Wiley Drake. I'm the chairman of the Congressional Prayer Conference. And again, thanks to Jim Lindsay and thanks to Jimmy Rogers. This has been a fun show. Good night, good day, and God bless.